What's going on, everyone? My name is Nicholas Merton here at Data Dash, and today is May 22nd of 2019. Well, folks, I hope you all are having a fantastic day wherever you are. And in today's video, I want to spend some time to try to do the impossible, and that is to simplify Bitcoin. I know it sounds like a crazy task, but I wanted to do this video because there's a lot of you out there from different walks of life, whether you're just getting involved in cryptocurrencies due to the technology or an interest in speculating on the price, and a lot of you out there as well who have been involved in crypto over the last year or two, or might have even been fans of the channel for some time, that continue to make a lot of the same mistakes. It's not meant as an insult. It's just that I've seen a lot of these common trends and problems with people approaching cryptocurrencies. They either don't have a fundamental understanding as to what Bitcoin really is, they do a lot of things that will lead you to losing money in cryptocurrencies, and they don't come in as you should in any market with a pre-planned, clean-cut, simplified strategy as to how to approach it in the long term. Okay, so I want to go ahead and cover those three topics today, as well as trying to answer a few different frequently asked questions towards the end. So we've got a lot to discuss, guys. I tend to ramble. I'm going to try to keep it as short, sweet, and to the point as possible. Let's go ahead and dive in to the most important point, and that is understanding what Bitcoin is fundamentally. So the first point to take into account in understanding Bitcoin is that Bitcoin is a non-correlated asset. Now, I hope it didn't scare you there. It's a very over-the-top financial term, as there tends to be a lot of in finance. What is a non-correlated asset? Well, let's go ahead and take a look at a correlated asset to get an understanding of what Bitcoin may be. A correlated asset is something that is usually tied to a financial market. So take the US dollar, for example. If the US economy tomorrow enters a recession or enters a global crash, for example, and we start to see pandemonium in the streets of, in America, the US dollar is going to lose a lot of its purchasing power. And vice versa, if the economy is rallying and doing really good, the dollar will probably gain a lot of strength compared to other currencies and different assets and have more purchasing power. So that's what it is to be a correlated asset. Bitcoin, on the other hand, is a non-correlated asset. It's not tied to anything directly. It's not tied to a nationality. It's not tied to a government, and it's not tied to a direct economy. It's a global peer-to-peer digital currency. So that's the next step we need to talk about as well. Bitcoin is not only a new emerging currency, as most cryptocurrencies are, but along with that, it's an emerging store of value. So this kind of this combination of storing value in currency as well makes Bitcoin very, very interesting. It's really what's known as the fifth evolution of money. So if we go all the way back in time, and we understand the different steps to understanding what's been used as currency and money in the past. We started off with commodity money. This was where small tribes and villages would exchange things like shells, things that weren't very limited and weren't very good for commerce. They were convenient to exchange, but they weren't good because they weren't limited. Well, gold fixed that. Gold was the second evolution. Gold had a limited supply. It took work to produce, and it had a lot of the properties that were desirable for money, in this case, fungibility over time, etc. And then we went on to something that was more convenient again. We kind of go through these cycles where we went towards using paper money, IOUs. And this is what we still use to this day as cash, physical cash that we have, the US dollar, the euro, etc. Then we went to using digital money, another form of using cash, where we did, we used credit cards and debit cards, and we used digital accounting. And now we've gotten to the fifth step. We've gotten to where we've been able to create something that has all the conveniences of modern day currency, in this case, where we can actually do business peer-to-peer, we can send money globally and do it without any needed permission. But along with that, we have the finite properties of gold. We have a limited supply at 21 million, not like gold, where gold can still experience inflation due to new gold being made. Over the past century, for example, we've seen around a 1% to 2% inflation rate for gold, meaning that 1% or 2% of new gold is coming into the supply every year. Bitcoin has a finite cap at 21 million coins, making it an ultimate digital store of value and also convenient as currency. So if we're to try to take these values into perspective, before we even dive into price, let's understand scale of markets here. So we're going to take a look at a chart here that gives us a good picture of that. So this chart right here showed us Bitcoin when it was at around $100 billion. It's currently at around $140 billion. And a lot of people hear that number and they think, oh my God, I'm too late to the game. This is, you know, well beyond me. I better luck next time. I'll look for the next market. I would say that you couldn't be further from the truth if that's going through your head, guys. Don't let it get to you. And the reason I say that is because Bitcoin right now is sitting around $140 billion. If it tackles, for example, we're going to go off with a real conservative estimate. If it tackles 10% of global currency and global gold markets, well, how much would that be? How much potential could Bitcoin have? We're just doing 10% here. We're not even taking in this case, the full scale of what crypto could possibly go to or what Bitcoin could go to. So gold markets right now, which is really one of the biggest hedges and stores of value in the world, sits at around anywhere, you can get different numbers from different sites, from anywhere from $7 to $8 trillion. And seeing as we've got an estimate around 7.7 here, we're just going to go ahead and rough that off at around $8 trillion, seeing as this is around the spot price that gold is at the moment. And along with that, we have the broader global money supply sitting at around 90.4 trillion. This includes all coins, banknotes, money market accounts, as well as saving, checking, and time deposits. This is the statistic I recommend because it's taking the broader global money supply and it's making sure to take in money in the various forms that it can come in this case. So when we take the entire currency market and the entire gold market here, we get around an estimate in this case of around $100 trillion. So if we rough it off there, it's around $100 trillion. If we just tackle 10% of that, that means Bitcoin could go to around $10 trillion as an asset class, right? If we could just tackle that, we'd have a $10 trillion asset class. Now, in the sense of price, if you want to get some perspective, we're sitting at around $7,800 or $7,882 at the moment of this video. If you were to take that into account on price, that would mean Bitcoin would be well beyond $450,000. I think it actually roughs out around $460,000 to $470,000. So that's incredible. Not to mention, there's another point we need to take into account as we understand the fundamentals of Bitcoin. Over 3.79 million Bitcoins due to its earlier days where people were a lot less protective over their Bitcoin and didn't understand how valuable it would become, have actually been lost. And owning cryptocurrencies, you have to manage what's known as your private key. For a lot of you out there that you're new in the space, you might have heard about this, where when you own Bitcoin, unless it's in an exchange account, if it's in your wallet, you own that Bitcoin and you have to remember your private key. That's how you actually have ownership of the funds. And it's estimated that a little under 4 million Bitcoins are no longer in circulation. So that gives room for Bitcoin to move even higher in the long term if it really does become that digital store value for the world. So we've talked a lot about these fundamentals. We see that there's possibly, in this case, a huge chance of upside return here for Bitcoin and cryptocurrencies alike. Let's go ahead and talk about the things you shouldn't do right away. Before we even talk about strategy, guys, we got to get these out of the way. I want to make sure you hear these above anything. And that is, there's really two points that I want to put across here. The first one is to not day trade these markets, okay? There's two major reasons why I'm going to push that across, to not try to day trade these markets. If we take a look here at the hourly chart, cryptocurrencies are very volatile. You know, there is no way you can expect for Bitcoin to drop from 7,800 down to 6,100. This stuff happens due to a few coordinated players who have a large effect on the market, especially while it's so early on. There's just not enough what's known as liquidity, enough volume trading around to actually have a much more consistent, predictable price pattern, okay? Do not try to trade these markets, or at least don't try to day trade. Don't try to buy and sell on the same day. I can guarantee you guys, statistics are on my side on this. You will most likely lose out. And if you don't lose out, you might make money still. You will likely would have been better off just simply holding or doing something that's much more casual, which is known as swing trading, trading the longer term cycles, right? Statistics will back that up. You guys can look up in any market, that is usually the case. And along with this as well, there's another thing to take into mind, and that is that with Bitcoin, it tends to be that on a few select days out of the year, it's where we see the vast majority of gains for Bitcoin. There's a few days out of the year, I think it's around 80 to 90 days, that really yield the best up days for Bitcoin. And if you're trading, and let's say, for example, you've exited your position and you're not in the market during those days, you're missing out on a lot of easy gains right there that you could easily be making. Okay, so that's one thing as well. And then another thing as well to build on this, guys, it's a pretty simple point. Don't get caught in the noise and overcomplicate things. We do daily updates here on the channel. We try to analyze kind of the shorter term action in markets, try to find when we can get those good dips. But we stick to some very core fundamentals as well. We don't let the noise get in the way. We don't let, you know, pundits get in the way, let news outlets get in the way. Don't listen to the news, guys. It's not going to give you good guidance. Listen to what the market is telling you. Listen to what the price is saying. Alrighty, everyone, I know you all have waited long enough. Let's go ahead and dive into step three, and that is the strategy. How do I approach investing in cryptocurrencies long term? So let's go ahead and understand the first key thing that's true with Bitcoin and just about any market. We're actually going to turn off our drawing tools here for this, and that is to understand that Bitcoin moves in cycles. All right, just like any other market, Bitcoin has cycles. So There's really three steps that we need to understand here. The first one is the one that everyone's always excited in, and that is the bull market, right? When we're in an uptrend, when markets are moving higher and higher, and in fact, usually take on exponential movement towards the peak of the market. We can see this here for pretty much every bull market for Bitcoin, right? Now, the second phase as well that we have is the bear market in this case. This is where we usually have around an 80% retracement, and we're going to talk about the importance of that in just a moment, where Bitcoin has a pretty sharp correction. What tends to come up must come down to some degree. And then eventually, the final third phase, which is the consolidation or capitulation phase. I like to use the term consolidation. I think it fits more in line with the sideways price action that you find here. We can see it back here in the early part of 2015, as well as the early part of 2019, where Bitcoin was moving sideways and doesn't really have much of a trend. So now that we know how to take this into account, let's go ahead and talk about how we start to enter into the strategy. Where do we first feel comfortable about buying into Bitcoin? Well, the first area where I start to feel comfortable about buying Bitcoin is after we've had an 80% retracement. So this is true for both of, actually all three major corrections here tend to have been around the 80-something percent range. 82% here, for example, back in 2013 with the first major sharp correction in Bitcoin. Then 86% here, for example, after 2014, when Bitcoin peaked out at around $1,000. And then also at 20,000 here, back in 2017, where in about a year, we had an 84% retracement in the value of Bitcoin. These are very sharp corrections, and you don't want to try to trade in between these guys. I can tell you, I mean, sometimes you can try to play these dips, but I recommend for the average person to wait. If you're a long-term investor, if you want to keep this as minimalistic as possible, wait until you've had the 80% plus retracement and start to look towards this sideways price action. When you start to get that consolidation, it doesn't really matter if you get Bitcoin at 220 or 290, because in the grand scheme of things, you're really trying to play for the exponential return for the next cycle, right? That's what we're really trying to focus on. Don't get caught up in the short term. So now that we understand this is really the safe zone, this is where we can start to get a little bit interested in investing. What we want to look for as well is look for corrections afterwards. Now that we've started to enter into a phase where we're going to be entering in an uptrend, as we can see here, we want to look for corrections. And there's a very consistent trend that we find here over time during the last market cycle, and that is that corrections are actually quite predictable in bull markets. We can see, for example, the first one down here that actually got us out of the consolidation phase was a 41.7% correction. For here, for example, 40% correction, 34%, 31%, 39%, 41%, and 29%. What do all these have in common? They're pretty much at a range of 30 to 40%. So my kind of game rule here, and again, you guys can do this in any way you want, this is just personally what I do, is that when Bitcoin goes through a 30% correction, I add in. If I have cash on the side, if I have money that I want to put into cryptocurrencies, that's the moment I do it. That's the moment I add to my position. And I do that as I did many times actually during this correction. I did it here, for example, when I called the top at around 3,000 for the short term. I added around the $19,000 to $2,000 range. And along with that as well, I added here back when we had the dip from 5,000 down to around the 3,000 to 3,200 range, depending on what exchange you were looking at. So that's what we want to do here. We want to add on those dips. Now, there's a third step to all of this. You've been, most likely, if you follow the strategy, you added your base position here, you've been adding all the way up. It's very difficult to time markets, guys, and this is an optional thing. Some people just tell you to HODL in crypto, but it is pretty much guaranteed that we are going to have an 80% something correction afterwards once we top out in the market. And it's not too difficult to read tops, and you will never probably time the exact top. But what I would say is that when price starts to move exponential and we start to get towards very key even levels, for example, like 20,000, like a lot of people are watching, at those moments when you start to see a sharp few days of sell-off and it starts to seem as if this parabolic trend is starting to break, that's when you can start to take in some profits if you want. Again, you guys got to decide that for yourself. Some people say, hey man, just HODL, don't try to time it. But again, these are much easier to predict, the longer term swings, and it's why I tell people not to focus on the short term. The longer term paints a much clearer picture. And again, we repeat that cycle. So just in summary, again, we wait for that consolidation period. So down here at around 3,000, where a lot of people in the market were calling for 2,000 or 1,000, that's not the time to get bearish, guys. When price is moving sideways and we've had the 80% plus correction, that's when we start to get bullish. And again, it looks like we're very much repeating the same exact historical cycles we've seen before. Maybe a little bit different, obviously a much higher price range, but it's those same fundamental principles of percentage points, levels that we've seen, and corrections that we've seen in the past. So that's the major points, guys, that I wanted to really kind of transpire in this video. You can always come back to this and use this as a ground foundation for understanding how cryptocurrencies, or more predominantly how Bitcoin, moves in the long term. And I have no doubt that even though we might have a variation of how long these bear markets last, or how long the bull markets last, or how high or low we're going, this will continue to play in a very similar fashion, okay? It's just a matter of cutting out the noise and not getting too greedy, playing that fundamental game that we've seen has worked in previous markets and has worked consistently in Bitcoin. Now, I want to go ahead and answer a few questions before we wrap this up. Some people have asked, Nick, okay, this is great, you focused in on Bitcoin, but can we get an in-depth analysis on how you trade altcoins? Well, in this video, because I'm giving you the simplified, you know, kind of streamlined way as to how I invest in Bitcoin, I'm going to do the same here for altcoins. I want to take a good example here. This was ARK, for example. This was a altcoin that, I'm going to bring it up here in exchange where we have a little bit more price history to it. There we go. So ARK here, for example, was an altcoin back during 2017 that did quite well, much like many altcoins. And we'll actually find that we're taking a look at the logarithmic chart here. As you can see, if we were to take off the logarithmic chart, it starts to really get exponential here towards July, towards the peak of the market, or really actually this is a little bit earlier in September of 2017. It tends to be that as you get more and more closer towards the peak of a bull market, more risk comes on, liquidity exits out of Bitcoin, and it goes into altcoins. It goes into other more speculative plays that are usually much more smaller in value. So I say that as you go through that that phase where you start to enter into a bull market, that's where I start to feel comfortable adding into altcoins. And you can basically, as you start to see these exponential run-ups, basically average down, right, as we did with Bitcoin, on these 80 to 90% corrections. I usually expect a little bit sharper of corrections for altcoins, and these are within this is a daily chart here, just to really put some perspective. You can see altcoins have some pretty sharp corrections here. So I'd say, you know, sometimes it depends on what altcoin you're looking at. You'll see 60% corrections, 70% corrections, things like that. Again, you want to wait till you see a nice cutback and then maybe average down if you really want to play it for the broader cycle to increase your Bitcoin position, or maybe if you just want a larger position in that altcoin that you really think could be one of the leading cryptocurrencies. So that's it for the video, guys. I hope you all enjoyed the coverage of what we talked about today. I hope I was able to simplify it for a lot of you. And again, if you guys have any questions, leave it down in the comments down below. Either myself or someone else will get to answering your question for you and helping you out. But until the next video, everyone, thank you all so much for watching. And if you are new to the channel, consider subscribing. I'd really appreciate it. And if you do subscribe, hit that bell icon. That being said, guys, thank you all so much for watching. And until the next video, I'll see you all in the next one. Stay tuned.